How many times I see this, I just cannot be cannot describe. Spontaneity that piece of footage conveys. This is an exceptional presentation of that footage. Oftentimes, if all you've seen are the licensed VHS depictions that are often utilized by the cable television networks, you really don't appreciate the content of information that's present in this piece of footage. I've had colleagues, Dr. David Day once made a remark that it was so blurry, so ambiguous, so indistinguishable that you couldn't even discern facial features on the creature in that image. And that's simply not true. We'll emphasize that as we go along here. My first exposure to this came in 1969 when I was a young lad of about 11 in Spokane, Washington. And Roger was making his circuit, showing the film at various locations, showing his documentary, which showcased that 60 seconds of footage. And I had never heard of Bigfoot before. I remember distinctly, we were actually at school one evening, the evening prior to the showing. And it was in the evening because we had one of those, some of you my generation may remember, the Gymkhana programs that we put on for the parents to show what we actually did in physical education. For you younger people, that was when we actually went out and did sports at school, regular school hours. Anyway, and so while we're waiting as a class for our opportunity to go put on our little demonstration, we're in our classroom at night, you know, and somebody had seen the advertisement for this Bigfoot and had the Reader's Digest article that showed some of the pictures, and oh, it was just fascinating. I had never heard this, but I, at that time, was intrigued, as many kids my age, with all things prehistoric and mysterious, the Bermuda Triangle, the Hollow Earth theory, you know, and human evolution and dinosaurs and all that. And this seemed to embody so much of those various phenomena. So I remember running home, because my parents stayed for my part of the program and then left. And then we had to stay for the whole thing. But I remember running home, which was about three blocks down the road, but at night, with these gigantic ponderosa pines that are all around Spokane, thinking that there was a Bigfoot behind every pine tree. But I got home and I opened up the paper and there was the article and I said, Dad, we've got to go see this. And so I convinced my dad to take my brother and me to the showing. We were on the third row seat in the Spokane Coliseum and Roger came out on the stage, introduced the documentary after we came out and answered some questions. And then they passed out an application to become a member of the Northwest Research Association. And membership dues brought you also, in addition to a nice certificate, you got a 5x7 color print and information on how to purchase that first edition of The Abominable Snowman, Let You Come to Life. Here's my dog-eared and weather-beaten and covered with that clear plastic contact paper now to preserve a little better. And you could also order a footprint cast. It wasn't this one, but it was actually a very poor facsimile of one of the two prints made by Roger. Now, this I actually got later from the North American Wildlife Research Association. And Mark had some literature, even a membership certificate from that organization, which was run by Ron Olson, who sort of morphed the Northwest Research Association into the North American Wildlife Research Association. Anyway, the question is anybody in here a charter member of the Northwest Research Association? Or have one of those 5x7 color prints or the cans? You know, I've been asking this all year long. Those of you that have been, those of you who go to every one of these conferences and have heard this talk already, I'm beginning to believe I was the only member. Because nobody has written it. You know someone. Okay. anyway, so that is how I came to be the sole possessor of this, which was one of several casts made by Roger Patterson on Bluff Creek just near Laird Meadow in 1964 or 63. You got to show me where that reference is. Cliff found a reference that suggested it might actually be 1963. Although in the book, that the original is figured and it doesn't equal 1964. That's what. Any case. So that that print. Oh, and I want to say that besides obviously having that very brief encounter with Roger, which didn't go beyond that, seeing him on the stage, I had come to become very good friends with Bob Gibbon. And you all know you can't spend 5 minutes with this gentleman and not be absolutely convinced he's a salt of the earth. I mean, he's a straight arrow Boy Scout. So, and that lens to hear the story firsthand from Bob's mouth lends a great deal to that this story, this anecdote. Nevertheless, now, how many of you seen this cartoon? It's become some of the euphemism that is pervasive. For those of you that think, well, I think I'll give it or can't read that. But I don't get it, no matter how many photos I take, you keep coming out blurry and indistinguishable. There's this constant, as I alluded to at the beginning, this constant attitude that this is some subpar piece of photographic evidence. And that's simply not true. The camera had a lens that had a fixed focus. That means anything past about 16 inches from the lens to infinity would be.
Hey, Wayne, I'm wearing your shirt.
There's motion.
I got it yesterday.
Because it appears that the frame.
Welcome in, Jason. Hey,
was
Keith.
Down at about somewhere between 16 and 18 frames per second instead of the typical, which would be 22 frames per second for broadcast quality. Back in the time when they were actually using
actually Facebook Live
film,
on this one.
You know, a little different than today's digital. But the slower frame speed meant that there was a little longer exposure time and more potential for motion blur. But
hey,
what
Loriana.
We see when we look at that image, it's not blurriness. It is we have blown up a feature that's about a millimeter tall on this 16-millimeter square frame.
Hey, James.
To this big. Now, we're not talking about pixelization because we're talking about grains, photographic grains on the film emulsion, on the plastic platinum film. And that only has so much resolution. When you blow that image up, then it starts to look patchy and fuzzy, but it's not really out of focus. Now, there is one caveat to that, and we'll get to that at the very end. But for now, as I contemplate, this is a scan, a high-resolution scan of that 5x7 color print that I got back in 1969. And it's really impressive. You know, even compared to this print over here, which still has some problems with it. There's still some question as to how some of this facial detail was introduced, I can't say I have the full story. That this is almost certainly a direct print from the original film frame that Roger had commissioned, and so that was what he saw, right, Bob?
Right.
Okay. Now I always wonder if there was that print of such quality, why weren't there several or many more made for the film at that same time? And again, this is kind of, I haven't worked out the whole detail of the situation, but Chris Murphy has put forward some scans of frames, that apparently photographic prints, that had languished in a safe, and someone had forgotten the combination to. It was eventually opened, and these were sort of rediscovered, these prints. The frames themselves obviously weren't unknown. And these images you've seen elsewhere. But look at the quality, and we couldn't have asked for a better format for you to look at these on. And I'm just going to flash through these for the sake of time. But look, you know, these are in focus. I mean, it's just as simple as that. And the stunning, now the only thing that might, well, tell me, Cliff was witness to the product and the process by which multiple images from several copies, several first-generation copies, were superimposed spit and then averaged the edging of it, and it produced a composite that was a tremendously better resolution. And Cliff, when he was describing it to me, he said when it came up on the screen, there was an audible gasp from the onlookers because of the tremendous quality. Do these images come close to that, or?
Yeah, yes. Very close.
So denser image, image quality, denser color, saturation, and remarkable clarity. I mean, some of these, you know, and notice some of the details as you're looking and just being awed by it. Look at the slope on that forehead. Look at the forward set of the head on the shoulders. Look, let me go back just a second to draw attention to this. It's stunning, really. Look at the length of that arm hanging absolutely vertical. The high-stepping gait. Cliff did a great job of talking about some of these features as they relate to the way in which this creature walks in a distinctive fashion from that of a human gait. Then we get a side view. Look at that flat face. We're going to talk about that a lot here. And the lack of a forehead. There's no forehead. It goes from that brow. It just flares back. We don't know how much hair. If that's a top knot, like on a gorilla or a bat.
Hey, Amy. Good to see you.
Or if the hair stands on end with when it's agitated. Have you ever seen, say, a gorilla or a chimpanzee when they're really agitated? And they're, or your cat when it's agitated. And that sleek tail suddenly bounces out to a raccoon-looking tail. Flat face. See that heavy arm. Big shoulders. Thick shoulders from front to back. Turning back to look. I just can't imagine what must have been going through Bob's mind. Bob had a much better view. He realized Roger's looking through this little viewfinder.
Mm-hmm.
What it's like looking through a viewfinder, and it makes the image look really small. But Bob was sitting there on his horse and preparing to dismount. What he must have thought is this thing turned back. Now, in spite of that dramatic piece of video imagery, or film imagery, you know, of a quality that far surpasses what most of the public is aware of and has seen, when Roger presented that evidence to the scientific community, he was faced with this solid, unyielding wall of rejection. And that wall, here represented by these puzzle pieces, did not permit any accommodation for what the Patterson-Gimlin film represented, what it implicated. And that wall represents a scientific paradigm, a set of assumptions, of preconceptions even, notions about what was acceptable, what was orthodox. And the paradigm that was dominating, and this was the theme I pounded last year as we talked about the possibility of Sasquatch, was referred to as the single species hypothesis in anthropology. It was based on a notion that was originally derived from microbiology. It was used extensively in ecology. A simple notion that was quite profound. Observation that no two species could occupy exactly the same niche. One, because of its slightly different set of adaptations, would be a little bit better at making a living under those conditions than the other, and would drive it to extinction, or would drive it to displace its characters to either take on new adaptations or become extinct. It was thought then that the hominin niche was a very peculiar one, which in its broadest sense might be defined by things like bipedalism, braininess, and above all, culture. And therefore, it must be a fairly exclusive club, which led to this notion of the single species. There could be one species of hominin on the Earth at a time. All right, and this was reinforced by the misconception of what a figure like this was trying to convey. This iconic figure that you've seen probably lots of different iterations of it, in some rather tongue-in-cheek and comical and so forth. But coming from this Time Life Nature Library book that was widely read back when I was a that this holdup, which gave us the suggestion that evolution proceeded in this inexorable single-file march. One species giving rise to a subsequent, and then falling away or going extinct, and so on down the road. All right. Now, it's interesting. A little side here. It's been said that a telling test of hypothesis is whether it stands at odds with conventional wisdom of the time, and then, but actually predicts future knowledge, which comes to be borne out. And so at the time, the proposition, the hypothesis that there's a subhuman relic hominid in Northern California, which seemed to be totally at odds with our concept of apeness, and what we thought distinguished our hominid ancestors who had separated from that ape heritage. It just wasn't acceptable. It didn't fit the paradigm. Now, the theme that I really want to drive home tonight is this, that now in hindsight, 50 years later, we can see very clearly that the Patterson-Gimlin film actually anticipated current anthropological understanding of hominid evolution in a number of ways. Okay? That text, it was obviously at odds with the prevailing paradigm in 1967, was rejected out of hand by academics, by anthropologists and scientists from other related disciplines when Roger brought it forward. But now, in hindsight, we'll see some interesting things, such as this combination of the small brain and bipedalism. There's long been debates in anthropology about which came first, bipedalism or big brains, and where did tools fit in? Did the evolution of tools then stimulate the growth of a bigger brain, or did it take a bigger brain to be in place before tools were discovered and utilized? And did the use of tools and the need to free the hands select for bipedalism, or what? And this went back and forth and roundabout. I mean, since the mid-1800s, there were discussions on along this line. But we'll talk about that in just a minute. Retention of midfoot flexibility, which you learned a lot about last night, and non-divergent howlings. This was thought to be an unanticipated combination or an incongruous combination. The big toe, it was argued, only became non-divergent to be incorporated into the longitudinal arch. Well, we now know quite differently that the longitudinal arch is something that evolved very late in human evolution, probably with our own species or our immediate predecessors. But early hominids were walking on flat, flexible feet, as we learned last night, for probably millions of years before an arch. The toe became non-divergent because there was no longer selection pressure to have a grassy foot to climb up in the trees because they were walking on the ground, finding resources there. Deep jaws and a flat face, that was an odd combination because the flat face was a modern human adaptation. The reduction of that projecting lower jaw, the prognathism, combined with the reduction of the jaws, our face getting smaller, being tucked underneath this big lobular brain head, with our teeth getting so small that we started to lose our wisdom teeth, or if you were like me, if you had braces in my era, they pulled out four of your premolars as well as your wisdom teeth to make room for the teeth in our tiny jaws. But they have a flat face combined with deep, deep jaws and gigantic teeth. That was unheard of. Non-projecting canines. As we'll see, it was thought that canines, the loss of a canine was associated with the adoption of tools. You replace this tool with one that you can carry around, stick in your pocket. That turned out to be wrong as well. So, one of the early critics, and it was actually from a fairly sympathetic quarter, Dr. John Napier, who was the father of primate locomotion, who went on to write a book about Sasquatch, about Bigfoot and Sasquatch. Well, it was called Bigfoot, Sasquatch, Yeti, in Myth and Reality. That was it. And one of the statements, he was one of the early observers and critics of the film, when it was shown to the Smithsonian, he looked at it and he said, from the waist up, it looks like a gorilla or a chimpanzee, like an ape. From the waist down, it has these long legs of a biped. It's inconceivable, this is his exact words, it's inconceivable that that combination of adaptations would exist in nature. Alright. After that big dinner, too much barbecue brisket. Alright, so inconceivable. Remember that show, how many of you know The Princess Bride?
Yeah.
Inconceivable. And Montoya says, you keep saying that word. I do not think you know what that word means. So he, you know, he was thinking it was this inconceivable mosaic. Well, what happens about 10 years later? We have a more extensive fossil record of early Australopithecines, namely Lucy, the famous Australopithecus afarensis, and we could hear these anthropologists saying, isn't this interesting? From the waist up, she looks just like a chimpanzee, but from the waist down, she looks like a hairy human. Isn't it interesting how evolution has proceeded in a mosaic fashion with new combinations of traits? Well, now, wait a minute. 10 years ago, it was inconceivable that it be suggested that such a combination could exist. And on that basis, the film won, on that basis for one fact, was rejected. We have a much different notion of what early hominin adaptations, combinations of adaptations were. So the idea of a small brain, bipedal, non-tool using hominin is common knowledge now. And absolutely congruent with what was proposed in 1967, walking across that sandbar on Bluff Creek. So, what's happened? Well, we're experiencing a paradigm shift. And it's taken a while. It's like turning the Titanic. But a paradigm shift, as proposed by the philosopher Thomas Kuhn, he wrote a very influential book that came out right while I was a graduate student, called The Structure of Scientific Revolutions. And he said that a paradigm shift was a fundamental change change in the basic assumptions and methodologies of the scientific discipline. Assumptions, you know, based on limited knowledge. As an example, in his book, he offered this figure. Now, how many of you look at that and see a cute little bunny? Okay, interesting. Only one or two hands. How many of you see a bird? A seagull.
Yeah, it looks like a bird, yeah.
So, a shift in paradigm. Now, if I could, you know, say some things and say, well, see, can't you see the little round face and the nose fits in there and the eyes and the little ears back here? So on, I might persuade you that to see that same piece of information in a different way. Based on your frame of reference, based on your past experiences and knowledge and so forth, your information. Well, 50 years
very
later,
cool job.
Here I am, white beard and all, standing before the facade of science, the scientific establishment, Dr. Grant's like to refer to it. And because of that tremendous, burgeoning flood of information about early human evolution, that wall that Roger encountered has expanded more information, which by de facto has created a niche for what I'm going to refer to as relic hominins. Mm-hmm. Not just Sasquatch, but perhaps even other forms around the world, like the Yeti, the Omnus, the Orangutan Deck. Now we might now see the single species hypothesis replaced with something like this, the persistent multi-species hypothesis. Clearly, most academics would now readily accept the notion of a multi-species hypothesis, which has supplanted the single-species hypothesis. But I would suggest that the evidence indicates that some of those branches of that now very bushy tree, instead of a single-file marching line of hominins, some of those branches have persisted until very recently, if not into the very present. And in the face of so much evidence, why would we think otherwise? Now it's starting to, the notion of Sasquatch is starting to become a little more accepted. You've seen this. Good evidence. No one is going to believe this, an actual working payphone. when the rarity of a payphone trumps the potential existence of Sasquatch. You know that, at least in the public mind, the possible existence of such a creature is pretty well accepted. Mm-hmm. At least acknowledged, to put it that way. Acknowledged. Now, on a more serious note, very recently, in 2012, in a popular science magazine from Britain entitled New Scientist, be like Our Scientific American or Discover Magazine, there was a feature article which addressed the 10 biggest questions. What were the 10 biggest questions facing researchers in human evolution today? And you can look, it's kind of interesting because some of these encompass the very types of features that had been utilized or had been confused or improperly assumed in the formation of single species hypothesis. But number 9, the editors included, and realize this is coming from the editors of the magazine, but they have no scientific advisory board, I'm sure, are other hominins alive today? Now, unfortunately, the editor, the associate editor who was in charge of that, who interviewed me for the article, did not write a very good article. I mean, it's like they, even though they give it a nod, they can't help but still not quite take it seriously. And so they have to give it a slightly negative or incredulous spin to it. Hmm. But it opened the door, particularly the acknowledgement, the concession of the very possible legitimacy of such a question was a huge, huge concession. Wouldn't have happened 15, 20 years ago, for sure. All right, so we've got this paradigm shift that has now acknowledged the possibility of the existence of such creatures. So what do we feel, what constitutes, you know, in addition to the Patterson-Gimlin film, that piece of that puzzle piece that fits into that expanded paradigm, that shifting paradigm? Well, we heard a lot about the footprints from Cliff. Cliff last night said he was standing on the shoulders of giants. I was going to tease him and say, I got up this morning and man, my shoulders were so hard. But he did an excellent job, discussing some of the very basic distinctions of the Sasquatch foot. And I'm just going to touch a little bit about that, on that, and I'm going to focus more attention in the time I have on some other aspects of the anatomy. But here we have Roger with those two casts that he poured on that day, that fateful day. And as was pointed out, he chose the cleanest, clearest, flattest featureless prints, that which, in his mind, most represented what the foot looked like in order to make those two casts. Unfortunately, the lack of the dynamic signatures, which to a tracker are very insightful, gave the appearance that these were little more than carved wooden feet, made by carved wooden feet, as has been suggested over and over again. There is no question that the footprints on that sandbar were left by whatever we see in that film. The suggestion that these were somehow manufactured independently after the fact just has no basis whatsoever. It just doesn't make any sense. It's not even worth the time. You can clearly see the congruence between those two when juxtaposed like that. Mm-hmm. I'm so confident in the legitimacy of those footprints that I went out on the limb and proposed an ichnotaxon for the footprints. Now, ichnotaxonomy is a classification system that names tracks and traces. Not the track makers, but the tracks themselves. Now, it's kind of interesting. Dr. Krantz has suggested that we might be justified to name the Sasquatch on the basis of footprints in the absence of a type specimen. And unfortunately, while it was an interesting discussion or a suggestion for discussion, perhaps it was baseless. Unfortunately, there was no justification or rationale to do that. But he could have proposed for the tracts. I floated this notion to several of my colleagues who also study fossil, and usually ichnology deals with fossilized tracts, fossilized footprints and traces of species for whom the skeletal remains have not yet been found. But in order to categorize, catalog, and discuss, you know, put a handle on these in a systematic fashion, the sort of parataxonomy of ichnology has developed. So I floated this notion and was encouraged by my colleagues to pursue this, that this was an intriguing idea to attach a name to this. I presented at a symposium that was held at the New Mexico Museum of Natural History, an international symposium on Cenozoic tracts and traces, and to a very receptive audience. Very receptive audience. It was one naysayer. And it was interesting because he got hung up on that tipless, or on the photograph of the Lyell-Lackery track. And if you look at it just right, you know how some images, if you look at it one way, it appears to reverse positive versus negative relief. And that picture, to some individuals, if you look at it just right, it looks like it's actually bulging out of the sand rather than an impression in the sand. And he just couldn't get his mind wrapped around that. And he said, how do you know that what you're describing to me really exists? And he says, I look at that and I see it bulging out. And I said, well, the cast made by another investigator of that very footprint is right there on the table. If you come over and take a look at it, you'll see. He wouldn't have it. And finally, the crowd booed him. It was mentioned. So a room about this size of people from all over the world, literally international representation, were very positive about it and very, very interesting questions. They were very impressed with the footprint cast that I put on display on the side of the room. I went ahead then with further encouragement, and we published this paper, and it was reviewed by 5 reviewers. Usually they had 2 or 3. And so I wanted to make sure that it had an extra oomph to it. And so we got 5 reviewers who all came back very positive, and it was published. So Sasquatch tracts have a scientific name, which is Anthropoidopes Ameriboreales. Can you all say that?
Mm-hmm.
It just rolls right off your tongue, right? Anthropoidopes, which means, is the 8-foot, referring to anthropoid apes, man-like apes. Or you could just more rendered more literally, a man-like foot from North America, Ameriboreales. But the important part is not so much the name, the distinction of the name. The important part is the name is associated with a diagnosis, a differential diagnosis that enumerates, describes, and discusses the characteristics that distinguish this foot, distinguish it from human feet and other possible footprints that might be misconstrued as Sasquatch tracks. Now, you saw this. Here's the collection of 10 casts from the Patterson-Gimlin film site. Oh, I meant to say, the reason for mentioning that tonight is that the type specimens are the right and left tracks cast by Roger and Bob on the sandbar that day. High quality stylistic molds of those original tracks are housed at the Smithsonian in the Department of Anthropology. You know, the requirement is actually to have an original specimen. But in this case, because it wasn't a fossilized track, you know, the reviewers allowed that. But the fact that they were in the Smithsonian is important. And then the original casts are housed right where we were yesterday in the Willow Creek Museum. All right, so they exist. And in addition, that's inaccurate. I got ahead of myself. Not those, but the Titmus collection, which is referred to the types as a holotype, referred material, the 10 casts, which are in the Willow Creek Museum, further corroborate that or substantiate that taxon. And critical to that is this image here, this cast made by Bob Titmus, that you've all seen quite a bit now, which shows that impressive pressure ridge. It was photographed by Lyle Lackery about 10 days after the, or on the Monday following, excuse me, getting late. The dinner's setting in. on the Monday following the encounter, and then serendipitously, it was among the 10 tracks that Bob Titt was cast. Now here you can see it. Those originals have also been 3D scanned. And so those original, but those scanned files are also archived in a virtual footprint collection that I'm constructing, working on still, hosted on the Idaho State University server. Here's my interpretation, my reconstruction of what that foot looked like. We talked about that a little bit, so I'm going to kind of go by that kind of quick as we move on to the face. But this interpretation, I mean, I'm absolutely 100% confident in this. No doubt whatsoever. Because I can watch it taking place. I can watch the movement of the foot executing that kinematic, that action, on the film itself. You can maybe appreciate it a little more easily with the stills. But you can see the heel starts to go up, and this, as Cliff pointed out, there's a little topography. Plus the footprints are pressed in, you know, an inch to an inch and a half into that substrate. And so you don't have a perfect line of sight of the forefoot, but you can see the heel's coming up. By this point, that heel is vertical. The heel segment is almost vertical. If this was a stiff, rigid prosthetic, part of a costume, or alternately, if it was an arched foot, like a human foot, with a stiff, longitudinal arch, the remaining 6 to 8 inches of that foot would be sticking straight down into the sand. But they're not. It's not, rather. It's flexed there through the instep, through the mid-tarsal joint. And then it finally pushes off with less push off through the toes, interestingly. Because here, most of the center of gravity, with that forward lean, that forward set head with a massive face and deep jaws and dense teeth, the center of gravity is way out here. It's already over this foot. So the push-off is rather minimal. It already came right back here through the forefoot. And that's what causes this displacement here. The pressure coming down through the entire forefoot, not just at the heads of the metatarsals, as you learn. Then sometimes we'll displace material back towards the heel, which is now elevated so it won't be compressed underneath it. And it creates either a pressure ridge, or if the material fractures and fails altogether, it may cause a disc, just like a little landslide sliding up over into the heel. All right. Now, you saw this three-quarters view, which I shared with Cliff, but I held back something. I don't do that very often. But I wanted to show this. So if you rotate that all the way, and now you can really see, plus I lined the toes all up a little bit better than the text had done that made the original figure. And notice the position. One of the criticisms that has often been leveled against this interpretation is, well, if it has a flat, flexible foot that supposedly makes a pressure ridge, why is it only in that one track? Well, it's not. It's just hard to appreciate it from the view that we were seeing these casts from. Mm. As Cliff pointed out, he gave a couple of very interesting original examples. That one from Montana, which is stunning, showing the pressure ridge. And the Jerry Crew cast, when I for the first time actually got to see that at a three-quarter view, it suddenly was clear that there was the hint of a pressure ridge with differential pressure over that forefoot on that track as well. Even though it had never been appreciated, because we always saw it from the front, and we usually saw it in a state that it wasn't cleaned up very well. But this is also interesting. If you read Dr. Krantz's book, you know, he addresses the fact that some of these tracks are quite abbreviated looking. They're much shorter than the other ones. And he attributes that to just the natural variation you might expect if you measure, if you walk down a sand beach and measure each individual footprint, you know, he said you would find the same sort of thing. Well, that's true, to a degree, but a little hard to account for this kind of difference in tracks like this. But if you notice, when the toes are lined up and the forefeet are lined up, they're all proportioned and they're all aligned. The difference in length lies totally in the degree of impression of the heel. Well, remember, you know, one of the things that's missing If we had a series of human footprints like this, even accounting for the arch, which would exaggerate a little bit the impression of the heel, we walk with a distinctive heel stripe. We come down hard on our heels and have concentrated pressure under that heel, which causes it to be much deeper. And then we rock forward along the outside of the foot and we impress through the ball of the foot, which is in the metatarsal heads. If you have a hard time getting your head around the notion of the metatarsal, it's just a ball. The ball of your foot, it can either refer to just that prominent bulge under the big toe, or it can refer to the whole area across the front of the foot. That's the ball. So we have, one of the consequences of an arch is this differential pressure between the heel and the ball, and then it usually goes out through the big toe. This creature walks with a much more compliant gait, which means when the lead foot or the swing foot goes out, it isn't fully extended and comes down hard on the heel. It comes down compliantly on the bent knee, and there's less differential pressure under the heel. And if it's walking briskly, it's going to tend to actually be up on the fore part of the foot, meaning that the heel will press in less, to a lesser degree, and leave a more abbreviated or a very shallow. See how shallow this is here? Impression of the heel. So it's remarkable, consistent across all of the footprints. You know, to incorporate this kind of subtlety consistently, and yet distinctly, in such a way that only someone who understands the kinematics of human locomotion, non-human primate locomotion, gait analysis, would appreciate it. Just, you know, it's beyond comprehension. Okay, now let's go back to this again, where you concentrated on what's happening with this foot. But now I want you to look at the lead foot. What do you see right there? Right there.
Oh, yeah.
See those toes pointing up to the sky?
Mm-hmm.
And they look darn long, don't they? Those look quite, I mean, it almost looks like a duck foot sticking up. You know, a critic would look at that and say, oh, look, there's that Bozo the Clown. If you've ever seen the fake feet that come with some of these costumes, with just, you know, vacuous extensions to make the foot look longer, they often point up to the sky, just like Ronald McDonald's shoes. When I was working on a documentary at Stanford University with two experts in human locomotion, and they brought, the production company brought in an actor with a fairly expensive costume. The feet were remarkably crude. They were just a pair of leather loafers that they had glued on this artificial front foot sticking out, and it literally flopped when you walked. You know, so when that person walked, the toes never would leave an impression. They would never press into the ground at all. All right, but let's look at this now. You saw this already. Here's my reconstruction of the foot skeleton, the inference of the relative proportions. Now, I'm not worried if the ankle bone looks exactly like that in shape, but in placement, I'm quite confident. If we look at this extremely clear, remember Roger immediately made those footprint casts of these extremely fresh tracks in that moist sand. And it wasn't just a granitic sand, like you might find more commonly, say, you know, on the beach or somewhere. It was a very finely eroded shale, kind of a slate, that was produced grains that were extremely angular. So once impressed, they held that shape very well. And that's why, you know, John Green reminded Emden and Bob Titmus and Jim McLaren, these people could go back there a week later, 2 weeks later, 3 weeks later, and still see footprints in the ground. They held in there in spite of the weather, weather itself. And so, this almost is like a mold of the foot. I mean, if he got the least dynamic signature, the closest you would get to, say, just a standing imprint in that. In a mold. And it allows me to see, you know, the convexity here, to see a bulge here. That bulge corresponds undeniably to the tuberosity of the navicular bone here. We know the tangent here at this convexity would mark the position of the metatarsal phalangeal joint, the joint at the ball of the big toe. And those should be fairly lined up, you know, across here, that distance. Now, so notice, if that's the case, there's quite a bit of webbing that comes up past that knuckle of the foot. And in fact, when you look at the original, you can just barely see the end of it on this photograph. It's kind of hard to see. But on the original, you can see the slight indentation right there, which marks a flexion crease. Now, if you look at your hand, with its knuckles, our palm webs our fingers. It extends up between the digits, past the knuckles a little ways, such that when we flex our fingers, what happens? There has to be a flexion crease thrown up across there, right? And that's present there. Now, if you go home and look at your baby picture, her baby picture, look at your footprint on your birth certificate or your children's birth certificates, you'll find that you probably had a flexion crease of some sort. In some instances, it's quite distinct. It goes right across there. We're all born with that. It only fills in when you as an infant start to walk. And the sole pad begins to take on its more mature form. The sole pad thickens, and the connective tissue anchoring that tissue underneath the joint solidifies. Now, my ex-wife has feet which, from the bottom, look quite like she has stubby little toes. And her foot looks plump. She's a very petite, slender woman, but her feet were chunky looking. She could walk across the driveway to get the mail, you know, with grit and gravel from winter scattered across there, and not bad at all, not even flinch or wince. I'd walk out there, and boom, her tender foot. Could not do it. But she had another characteristic. Some of you heard this story, but I've had another. She had another. My wife hates me, or my ex-wife hated it when I tell this story, because she's my ex-wife now. She would bend her toes under her foot like this when she was sitting at the dinner table or watching a movie, you know, and barefoot. She just unconsciously would just curl her toes underneath, and it looked like these two fists on the end of her legs. She with her foot. And so one evening, she's on the couch and I'm on the floor, and her legs over my shoulder, and I'm doing my giving her a nice foot massage there for watching the movie. And I started losing interest in the movie, and my mind wandered, and I go, And I turned her foot over, and I pushed down on her toes, and boing, flexion crease right across the end of her foot. Mm-hmm. Just like, well, not just like, but resembling this, which is suggestive. Mm-hmm. So not very distinct, obviously, because this foot has experienced pressure, weight bearing, which causes the sole pad to expand laterally, and it will usually press out any flexion creases. You just don't see it because of the great weight on that foot. But nevertheless, there it is. Now, look at the length of those toes. Rene de Hinden has poo-pooed in the past some tracks, like those from Paul Freeman, because they were, quote, sausage toes. They were too long, he said, because he had in his mind this image of these peas in a pod toes across the end of the foot here, with very little discernible by way of toe stems. But, in reality, look how long those toes are. In fact, with that in mind, look at that. Mm-hmm. There they are. The same proportionality that I have suggested based on inference from the landmarks featured here. And then Cliff showed how if this figure is superimposed over independently, you know, this derived independently, but now superimposed over the tibialis cast, lo and behold, the pair of joints that serve as the axis of flexion through the midfoot fall exactly where they should in relationship to the resulting pressure ridge. So it's, you know, it bears up. The anatomy is there. It's actually there. Now here's one more subtle detail. Here's that pressure ridge, and the orientation is dictated by the position of the, what we call the talonavicular joint. So center of pressure right there under that navicular, and the talar head, more specific talar head, received by the navicular in that kind of concave shape. And the cuboid, offset even than I have it drawn here. The calcaneus actually comes to the hair further, which explains why the axis of flexion is a bit angled there. But I want to draw your attention to here. So these stars, at the center of these areas of pressure beneath these two joints, are indicated here. And notice this kind of golden arches shape here, this biconvex shape on the proximal edge of the forefoot. That marks the configuration of those two joints. Now, here's what really became interesting. I had the chance to go to China to examine some material over there. This was back with Monster Quest. And one of the highlights for me, obviously, was the chance to look at some footprints. A gentleman, by the, to give you the short story, but a gentleman by the name of Mr. Yuan had a sighting in the park, in the nature reserve. This is the Shenjia Nature Reserve, and it is a huge area of old growth forest, a remote area in Hubei province that has now been set aside as a big reserve. And I can't remember the figures now. I don't, but it was 30,000 to 300,000 square miles. Yeah, something like that. It's huge. It's a huge area. In any case, and there's only a couple of roads that barely penetrate into it, and they're just kind of dirt tracks. They're not really, they're jeep trails sort of type of roads. In any case, he had collected two footprint casts of this creature that he spotted and had tracked it and found where it apparently squatted next to a spring to drink water, standing in the mud on the thing, and in the process of squatting down, had rocked up onto the forefoot, not to the ball like we would because of our arch, but the, when the heel comes up, the pressure then is over the forefoot. And so not only did his track, I mean, I was flabbergasted. They wouldn't let me see the tracks, the casts, until they had the camera folded, so they wanted to capture my initial reaction. But I had handed him a reprint of the paper that had described the ichnotaxon. And one of the figures in that paper was this series of 3D scans of the titmus cast with the pressure ridge. And he can't read the English, but he's looking at the pictures, and he turns the page, and he sees that picture. And oh man, he grabbed my jacket, and he starts jerking on the sleeve. He's thumping the image, and I said, okay, so we get there, get all set up, and he brings out his little suitcase, opens it up, and unwraps out from these two casts. And this is the one of the two. And, you know, I was flabbergasted. There's the pressure ridge, and there's the biconcave feature that we just talked about on this Chinese track that was cast in 1995. Now, here's another one. This was cast by Paul Freeman at Mill Creek in the Blue Mountains outside of Walla Walla in 1991. And same deal, pressure ridge, same orientation, same position, and the biconcave feature there. Now here's the kicker though. I didn't publish an image of this cast, let alone a description of the interpretation of what this pressure ridge was until 1999, even though the cast was had in 1967. Bob kind of kept it to himself. I mean, there were a couple of published pictures of all of his tracks lined up, and that black and white screen photo that appears in John Green's book is so vague you can't really tell that's the cast with the pressure ridge. And of course, as Cliff pointed out, as Cliff pointed out, some people had looked at this and they saw these twigs sticking off here and thought that that was evidence that there was a green bough under the sand, which when stepped on was pressed down, but when pressure was released, bounced back up. And then, you know, just dismissed this as a singular artifact and not some dynamic feature of the footprint otherwise. Well, obviously, those twigs, tiny twigs, are not hooked onto anything over here. And it wouldn't account for the repeated appearance of that pressure ridge throughout the other tracks along that trackway. But so, it's, I mean, you ask for a smoking gun, how would you account for a Chinaman, a Chinese person, probably the I know nothing wrong for him, but I really didn't, that was not, that was not a who didn't speak English, who had no access to Western television, state controlled TV, I mean, it's kind of interesting. Here he's in the cinder block house with a corrugated tin roof and has a 42-inch flat screen TV. Incongruity of this, but of course, and he could watch some. There were some American reruns, I think, but most of it was just state-run TV. I mean, Dallas, maybe. So you find all those terrible capitalists. So you've got this man, and you have Paul Freeman, who was quite intelligent, an outdoorsman, and to some degree a naturalist. But he, when I started talking about foot morphology, he didn't know what I was talking about. But how could they have anticipated my discussions of 1999? And have created these before then. How would Roger Patterson have known anything about a mid-tarsal pressure ridge, the term mid-tarsal break, and how that would function in a flat, flexible foot, which the scientific community wouldn't even acknowledge was a possibility at that time? There's your smoking gun. Okay, now, let's change gears a little bit. Still with me? I know it's late, you can going to endure. Okay, a lot of people have asked about this. A really fun project we did. I'll turn on the afterburners when the lights be here. We reconstructed a skeleton of Sasquatch for the ooh-ah factor as far as the production company was concerned. We had some good discussions, but most of that was on the editing room where it was cut in editing. But nevertheless, it was really quite a fascinating project. They came to me and they said, we want to do something that utilizes 3D printing technology with Sasquatch, with a Sasquatch documentary. And I said, okay, well, 3D printer says, well, you could always print out, show how we can now print out 3D prints of these casts. We don't have to ship plaster casts around the country. Pretty soon, if the Smithsonian wants to do an exhibit, they can simply download the 3D files I have in the archive and print out facsimiles. And they go, no, that's, yeah. And I said, or you could do a skull. Of course, you know, you've got Grover's skull already, but his reconstruction of a Gigantopithecus skull, as an example. But there's actually a fellow who was corresponding with me who dug into the literature, found an obscure paper that described some Gigantopithecus teeth that were a full one-third bigger than the teeth in the jaw that Grover used in his reconstruction of the Gigantopithecus skull. And I said, that would be pretty interesting. You know, he was an artist, and which motivated his research, and he had modeled his interpretation of a Gigantopithecus skull, which wasn't quite a third big, he didn't go quite that big, he made about a quarter bigger, and it was impressive. I mean, it was really amazing to see. I said, that would be interesting. He said, well, that sounds good, but it'd be even better if we did a whole skeleton, and let's make it 10 feet tall. I go, that's a lot of printing. You know, we could do a half a skeleton and just hold it up to a mirror. Like a whole skeleton. That would save a lot of printing. It's all over. I said, well, 10 feet's a bit excessive. Really, that's a bit excessive. How about if we go 8.5? It'll still be impressive. And they said, okay, so how do we do this? Well, we don't want to really start from scratch. It's a lot of work to try to, you know, create a model from nothing. So I said, you know, recently there was a lot of fanfare about the completed composite of the Neanderthal skeleton. We could start with a robust skeleton of a pre-modern hominin, and then once we have that scan, we can stretch it, widen it, you know, whatever, alter the proportions digitally quite easily. And so it happened that Bone Clones had the license for this particular composite, and they agreed to let the production company make one scan and make one print of it, as long as they could have access in the future to the scan themselves. So they were good about doing it. So we did that. And then the question is, how are we going to alter it? And I didn't want to just completely speculate. So I said, well, let's take a known point of departure, and let's make the proportions similar to what Patty exhibits. You know, whether or not she's a typical Sasquatch, she still is, nevertheless, a Sasquatch. And so we could use her pattern. And so some of the work had already been done for us. John Green had made very careful tracings of the figure from the film, and had, based on the length of the foot, and there's always a bit of, you know, of ambiguity there because the film was a little bit overexposed, which meant that the highly reflective undersurface of the foot kind of washed out the margins of the foot just a little bit. So they looked kind of puffy. You know, that's what motivated Bob Barambas to say they were like those big slippers you did at Kmart. So he worked out the proportions. You know, so the absolute scale wasn't so important as it was just the proportion. Much of this had already been done too by Ruben Steindorf for the documentary Sasquatch Legend and Science by White Wolf Entertainment. So he got these limb proportions and the breadths right. His anatomy, his pelvis is a little funny here. He's got the acetabular kind of pinched in together and so forth. So the few things are a little bit off. But nevertheless, the proportions are there, except I've highlighted in blue, I didn't like his cranial reconstruction. Gave it much too much of a cranial bulk and didn't get the facial proportions accurate, as you'll see. So that was going to be substituted. And then this is just my worksheet. We're showing how we had the change we had to make from the Neanderthal skeleton to the proportions exhibited by Pat. And, you know, interesting things like her limb proportions, intermembral indices, and so forth, their index, excuse me, comparing the indices. And so the text sent me this early draft, and I looked at it and I said, guys, we said 8.5 feet, not 10 feet. Because I looked at that, I thought, it's got to be 10 feet tall. Well, it turns out that the Neanderthal skull or skeleton that we used was only 5'3" tall. They were very short, stout, short-lived individuals, like Inuits. Human populations in having very north there. And you'll notice the intermembral index. Even the short limbs of the Inuit, the upper limb and the lower limb are both short to about the same degree. So all humans have an intermembral index of roughly, on average, 71%, meaning the arm is 71% the length of the leg, the lower limb. Whereas Sasquatch is, they're much closer to one another, so 90%. That long upper limb and relatively shorter hind limb, you know, give the upper limb a length that is about 90% of the lower limb. Okay, in any case. So that was 8.5 feet, not 10 feet. As I said, why was it that we ditched the Neanderthal skull? Well, Neanderthals have a cranial capacity on average larger than ours. They're quite brainy. The brain is a little different shaped, maybe a little bit differently organized. But this skull of an early robust Australopithecine has a cranial capacity that's just over that of a chimpanzee. And it stood, that cranial capacity was for a creature that stood about 5 to 5.5 feet tall. Males and females were a little different in height. And here's why I felt justified in using that cranium instead. Here is this is Paranthropus boisei, a robust Australopithecine from East Africa. It lived about 2 million years down to about 800,000 years ago in East Africa. And look at the congruence. Point for point, from the top of the head, and notice the little tiny sagittal crest there, the big brow, lack of the forehead, the prominent cheekbone, the position of the nose, the depth of the maxilla, the flaring gonium, the angle over here on the jaw for the attachment of the masseter muscle, the depth of the chin, receding back. I mean, Bill Munns and I were going to do a project where, after creating a photogrammetrically derived 3D model of her head, we were going to use reverse forensic anthropology to peel away the layers until we came down to the skull. But I already know what it's going to look like based on the correlation of the surface anatomy. If we were to execute that project, accurately, it would look like this. I'm absolutely confident it would look almost exactly like this. Now, here's that interesting combination of features, the flat face and the deep, deep jaws with these massive muscles The temporalis muscle across here, filling the whole side of the skull, and even requiring a sagittal crest to provide additional attachment surface. And the massiver, attached along the zygomatic arch and out here to the cheekbone, which juts out to the side forward to provide additional attachment and leverage way out here in front, and a very flaring angle of the jaw to provide a little additional attachment for that very thick muscle. Here's a chimp, here's Lucy, showing sort of a progression of that adaptation that the extreme exhibited here. And then humans, where we've shrunken down the jaws, as I mentioned, and the muscles associated with it, with those jaws, are very small. Now, here are the teeth. The reason for those big, heavy jaws and that flat face is that most of the loading takes place on the post-canine teeth. There's the canine right there, that little peg. And the incisors are these little square stubs across the front, good for nipping off things, but not for scooping out fruit, fleshy fruit and whatnot. But the molars, the premolars rather, are like twice, three times the size of our molars. This in an animal that's only 5 to 5.5 feet tall. Now, what if we blew up that skull, supersized her, super Sasquatch sized her? Then it would look like this. Now, just to really impress you, there's the bite surface of the post-canine teeth, the premolars and molars, on both sides compared to that of a human. That's not a human. This is not a human adaptation. These are teeth that have enamel that is probably 3 to 5 times as thick as that on the human molars. And combined with that huge surface area and a very short canine that allows those to grind side to side. As you'll see when we have not quite yet, I'm ahead of myself. But anyway, I want to impress upon you, we were talking about dietary adaptations. And John dropped one word, which he didn't define, and probably, I don't know if many of you have heard it or understood it. He said durable phagy to eat. These are adaptations of animals that eat tough, durable, fibrous items or hard items. They're able to process things that would be inaccessible to many other animals, including bears. You know, he mentioned the canine teeth are important for carnivores. But the true carnivores also are defined by a carnassium, where the upper and lower teeth have narrowed to very blade-like proportions, so that, you know, how does your dog eat a piece of meat? They don't bite it with their incisors. The incisors of the canines are usually, or mostly used to grab and restrain and to rend, but then when they get down to really chewing off a chunk of meat, they're doing it back here. They position it over that carnassium, right down. And you can feel it. If monkey comes around, run your hand, and you'll feel that gigantic tooth up here that is shaped like a very sharp blade. That's part of the carnassium. And bears have reduced that tremendously. They widen the teeth back out so that they're grinding surfaces. But these creatures have done it to the extreme, to the far extreme. Now, that's significant because back when Paddy came on the scene, the notions of the role of projecting canines was still in the old school. When Rhamapithecus, this was a fossil that was found in the Shivaliks of Pakistan, was discovered, it has a non-projecting, a very short canine tooth, not as stubby as that robust Australopithecine. But here was the assumption. The assumption was that if you had a short tooth like that, then you must be relying on tools. And if you're making tools, you must be standing upright in order to free the hands, correct? So based on these two bits of jaw, this was how artists envisioned, how anthropologists envisioned Rhamapithecus, an early biped wielding tools, you know, long, long before tools ever emerged here 2 million years ago. Now, Rhamapithecus is viewed as an ape that looks something like this. An ape that had thick enamel, had a shorter face, and had the ability to grind rather than than simply chop. So large projecting canines of the gorilla limit their ability to grind side to side. The jaws are restricted to more up and down movements, just a minimal amount of side to side. But when you get rid of those canine teeth, then the teeth can grind back and forth.
Mm-hmm.
Now, this may seem like a lot of speculation, how many angels can dance on the head of a pin, but it's not. The only reason to have the facial proportions that we see in paddock is to support these kinds of teeth. The only reason to have that great depth and the massive masseter that actually casts a shadow because of that front edge across her face, and to have that the attachment for the temporalis expanded, the possibility of central crest, is to support teeth of these proportions, this adaptation. What would have been the inspiration for a giant hairy ape in 1967?
Mm-hmm.
The silver screen, the second most popular monster on the silver screen, which was King Kong. Do you know who the first was?
Frankenstein's monster.
Yes. But King Kong was patterned essentially after a gorilla. It wasn't supposed to be a gorilla. It wasn't just a giant gorilla. It's a different, but it was patterned after a gorilla. It certainly had the projecting muzzle, the prognathism, and projecting canines that we see in the gorilla dentition, in stark contrast to what we see here. But again, emphasizing that the now we know that an adaptation other than ours, of reduced facial proportions tucked under our skull with a flat face and reduced teeth, because we cook our meat. You know, that brisket, I didn't have to chew on that brisket very long before I could swallow it. But if you've eaten raw meat or chewed on turkey, you chew and chew and chew before you swallow. Anyway, that flat face, that combination, lack of a canine tooth, flat face, and look at the proportions, what the other implications are. Everything else agrees with her face, as and also her cranial proportions.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? Her cranial proportions. So she has a brain in on par proportion. In fact, it would actually be smaller. When you think of the girth that she shows by comparison to what this robust Australopithecine had, although we've qualified it. Let's just show this. If we put a human skull up there with the facial proportions lined up here, we have a brain that's 3 to 4 times the size of what we see on Sasquatch. So to echo what Cliff said last night, these are not people.
Hmm.
Unless you want to use people in the very generic term, like the Shoshone referred to bears as people. They are another being, and if by people you mean you're giving deference to that being, that they are not Homo sapiens. They're not some form of Homo sapiens. They're certainly not some hybrid form of species whatsoever. Now here's the interesting thing, again, this theme of anticipating, and I'll wrap this up pretty quick here. All these interesting alignments with Paranthropus, Roger couldn't just go down to the library and grab a book about early man and flip it open and goes, oh, that looks pretty good. That's what I think Sasquatch looks like. So we'll make Patty look like that. This skull wasn't discovered was discovered in 1959, but wasn't formally published, the description with photographs and so forth, until these were just press photos, until 1967. The first mandible was found in 1964, and the combination of that cranium then was first the first analysis of the significance of that flat face and big teeth and small canines, tiny incisors and jutting zygomatic bones and crest down the middle of the skull. That wasn't published until 1983. This was a doctoral dissertation by Joel Rack. 1983 versus 1967. So there was no model. There was nothing for him to borrow from to come up with that. And yet, what we see in the Patterson film, again, anticipates by decades things which are now considered common knowledge. All right, just a little more. Bear with me here. How many of you have heard this by eyewitnesses, the statement? It had no neck. Well, of course it had a neck, right? It had to have seven cervical vertebrae in its spine there. But what you know, Dr. Krantz tried to explain it as, you know, the way that the skull is positioned with the shoulder girdle up a little higher like apes. Well, the other confounding factor of apes is that they have a spine that comes into their skull far back on the cranium, where that of early Australopithecines, for example, are rather intermediate. The more bipedal, the more committed to upright posture, the more they were balanced. Now, human skull is even more balanced, in part because of the tremendous expansion of that brain. Our brain's not so big, with the foramen, the opening, or the spine so far under, and the face is not so much smaller, that it's a pretty good balancing act. You know, it's so good that I can see some of you can fall asleep with your head in a perfect upright point. Just like some of my students. No, I can say that. Those who live in glass houses, you know, I'm very good at church. I'm sitting there, and my eyes get kind of heavy. You know, I'm contemplating eternity. And occasionally I nod. My wife says I'm a narcoleptic. I've ever. Anyway, the point is that Dr. Krantz's explanation isn't very good, because if this creature must have a configuration that's more akin to this. Clearly we see Patty with her head very forward set. In fact, her whole spine is leaning forward about 5 degrees all the time that she's walking along there. When the skull is so out of balance compared to ours, like this gorilla with a big face, a jutting face, the small brain with the spine coming in from the back, notice that the trapezius, that superficial muscle that helps to hold the head up, is attached extremely high. There's a very broad attachment here, area of attachment for the muscles of the neck. In green, you see those of the trapezius, but notice how high up they come. Mm-hmm. Okay? Whereas in humans, they're quite small. Because we're so well balanced, it takes very little muscle effort. And so the traps just, you know, we look more pencil neck because of that little small jaw. Oh, and that was the point I missed. I missed one point I was supposed to say. When you have these big, big, deep jaws and a small neurocranium sitting on those seven cervical vertebrae, it covers them up. That tall, what we call the ramus, ascending ramus of the jaw, is so tall by comparison to ours that it simply covers up the neck in the front. Here you can see the exposed cervical vertebrae. Because our face is so small and our jaws are so narrow by comparison that we have all that space there. It almost rests on the collarbone there. All else being equal. Okay, now, cruising right along. Now, notice here. Here's the attachment of the trapezius, clearly visible on the film. But it's rather intermediate. It's not as high as the gorilla, but it's not as low as a human. Mm-hmm. It's rather intermediate, in agreement with your forward position head. Now, if you think about those broad shoulders, you know, I'm just under 6 foot. I've lost three lumbar vertebrae, collapsed during a result of a car accident. Mm. And so I'm about an inch and a half shorter. I have fairly broad shoulders. My shoulders are about 24 inches across. Her shoulders, standing at probably 6.5 to 7.5 feet tall, are 36 inches across. And when they rearticulated her, they didn't get, or this one, this skeleton, they put them too close together. These should actually be further apart. The space between the spine and shoulder blades should be more pronounced, really. But in any case, it still makes the point. The red outline indicates that outline of the trapezius muscle. Now look at here. There's the attachment we talked about. Look at the depth through there. Mm-hmm. That muscle coming down like a cape to the shoulders and coming down in a V, you can see it better from the more posterior advantage. But the thing that's most impressive is look at the thickness of that neck musculature. That's amazing. That's just powerful by comparison to... Oh, I cut that one in. All right, one last thing. Now I said that the film was in focus. The only caveat to that is the lens that was used was not corrected for chromatic aberration. That means as light comes through a lens, a simple convex lens, then if the color wavelengths are refracted differentially. That means some of the colors will fall into sharp focus on the film. Some of the color wavelengths will be slightly out of focus. Because of the differential refraction, they'll focus just a little past or just a little in front of the film platen. So with our modern technologies now, this was the result of an effort by first Rick Noble, who was commissioned by John Green to take a, I think it was a first or second generation copy of the film, but fairly clean, not been shown much. And then he set up a micrographic setup so that he could photograph digitally individual film frames at the highest resolution the film grain would tolerate. Once those digital images were had, in the computer you can what we call split the color channels. The color information can be separated into three channels, red, yellow, and blue. There we go. And it turns out the red was the wavelength that was in the sharpest focus. The other two would create just a little bit of haze. You know, like that Claritin commercial? They peel back the... Well, by removing that information, we lose a little bit of color information that becomes much, much sharper. And so that's... You've never seen it like that before. This is so cool that you can see it on these on this high-resolution monitors. Now, you can sit and stare at that thing. I'll show this to my graduate anatomy students, my physical therapy students, after we talk about the determinants of gait. And, of course, they've had a full-body dissection anatomy experience. And I'll say, all right, point out as many landmarks as you can identify. That you can identify. Of course, you start up here. We already talked about the attachment of the trapezius. You can see how that, you know, and that's the hardest part. We can spend all that talking about the costume aspects. But the most challenging part of the costume is the neck. And there are all kinds of tricks. You put leather tunics, the high leather collars on tunics, like Planet of the Apes. Or if you're, Bigfoot on the $6 million man, you have a 12-inch beard hanging down in front to cover up the neck. Mm-hmm. When they did the Grinch, they didn't cover the neck at all with fabric. They colored it green, the body paint. So, but yet she does the cardinal sin for anybody wearing a costume. She turns her head, which shouldn't throw up all kinds of wrinkles in a costume, but it doesn't. We can go down, you can see the deltoid muscle on the shoulder. You can go down and see, I can actually pick out the lateral and long head of the triceps. You can see, as she swings her arm, that little fold, that pec muscle right there, at her armpit, the front of the axilla. And we just go on down, and then let alone all the things you can see with her feet. The action of the mid-tarsal break. You can actually see as her foot swings, the recoil as it bends this way, and then straight back out as she swings her foot. I mean, it's just amazing. You can sit and watch that for a long, long time. So, to recap, a telling test of a hypothesis is whether it stands at odds with conventional wisdom of the time. Does it predict future knowledge? Indeed, the Patterson-Gilman film anticipated multiple aspects of current anthropological understanding that have now been borne out after 50 years of advancement of that discipline and further scrutiny of the film. Mm-hmm. Is this the end? I don't think so. I think it's just the beginning. We're just really beginning to understand what's on this piece of film and the implications of it. Thank you very much.